Morning. This is April Fool's Day 2017, and I'm going to talk about my gardening efforts this year. It looks to me like I've got something going on that I've never had before. I live in North Central Texas. The soil is alkaline, and I've lived here 27 years and really have never successfully gardened. Despite trying every year, I have little successes, but that's about it. You can't really grow vegetables here very well, but the blue bonnets do grow, and they are spectacular. So thank God for wildflowers in Texas. I'm going to talk about each of my areas. First, what we're looking at is where I have my potatoes planted. And I tested this a couple years ago, and it worked. It was too late in the season to have much of a crop. But what you do is you have cardboard down first, and then you have your good soil, mulchy soil stuff, and then you dump straw on the top. Well, this is rotted hay, okay? And just this past week, I planted these 3 weeks ago, but now they're just starting to pop through the straw. And they're actually just coming up all over this bed. So I'm very excited. And I expect to have a pretty great crop. Okay, so this is my the main thing I want to talk about today, although I'll show you some of my other things. But this year I'm trying something completely new. But it looks to me like it's going to be the ticket. You know, I think I got it planted early enough, early March. And the first day I planted, here there was a frost warning, so I had to go cover all the plants. Most of these beds were planted by seed. I had sprouted them first, just in paper towels, wet paper towels in a Ziploc bag. But okay, so the deal is a friend of mine, thank you, Brenda Lulu, thank you for sending me the article on hay bale gardening. And there's also a more popular straw bale gardening. And it got me thinking. I mean, I've been curious about all of these rotting big round bales sitting out in the fields in this part of Texas. Now, in 2015, we had 80 inches of rain, so that year was just a tremendous hay crop. You know, everyone got out there and baled every chance they got. So now what we have 2 years later is we have an abundance of bales sitting out in the field still that are becoming too old and moldy to feed to animals. So with that in mind, I put a little ad in some of the local classifieds. And anyway, I said anyone got some old round bales for me. And then also I called a guy that had a bale sitting along the side of the road. So one guy brought me 6 bales and another guy brought me 7 bales. The last 2 I gave to my neighbor, and so they're trying this too. But what you do is, you know, you turn the bale over. And then we finally figured out the thing to do was shrink wrap them. First, I just had some cheap plastic with duct tape. This wasn't working very well. And my husband said, well, why don't you get those binding straps they use for shipping? But in the process of looking at shipping materials, then I saw shrink wrap. So I said, well, dear, I think we should try shrink wrap. And he goes, I have some. So that was great. And his brother had some. And it's really not very expensive. So I'm just going to go bale by bale. What you have to do first is you have to condition them. So I got some nitrogen fertilizer from Athens Farm and Garden in Athens, Texas. And we condition them by, it's like every other day you put some nitrogen, you're constantly watering them because they get very, very hot. But it's also required for the conditioning. But you put nitrogen on one day, and then you leave it a day and you just keep watering it and do it every other day for 10 days and then you stop. Now these bales, now when I watched the articles about just the square bale gardening, you know, they said the bales might get to 140 degrees when they get really hot. Well, these guys, I mean, all of them got to at least 150, but like these older ones, like this one that were more decayed, this bale was 185 degrees plus. That was as high as my thermometer would go. So, okay, I'm pausing for a moment. Okay, so this is my meat thermometer I stole from a kitchen. So let's just see how hot these guys are right now. Okay, so put that down in, and so it goes down about 6 inches, turn it on. I suspect it's not even going to register. Oh, it says 109, 110. Okay, there's still some heat down in there. 113, 14, 15, 16. Okay, so it's still plenty hot down inside. 17. Okay, I'm going to take you out and let's try this one over here. Now, this is the bale that got really, really, really hot. In fact, okay, so I have tomatoes in this one. Let me back up. Watermelon. I've never successfully grown watermelon, although people do. So, and there's some little weeds. The weeds are not from the bale, though. The weeds are from my mulch. So my mulch came from, well, 2 years ago, the electric company was going around and trimming the trees and then mulching them into these big trucks. And I went up to the guy and I said, would you like to dump some of those at my house? So we have 60 acres here. Non-tillable, really. But anyway, he brought me 7 loads. So 2 years later, these guys just popped up right away. So I put the mulchy stuff on top of the bale for the seeds, okay? And they were already sprouted, and they came up within a few days. So these guys, it's less than 2 weeks. It's when I actually got them planted. But, you know, you can see they already have, multiple leaves and things. Okay, back over here to my tomato. I have 2 bales that are tomatoes, and I use the oldest, mulchiest ones. And you see some of them look a little sad. Okay, but if you look at the center, they're coming back. I have planted some of these too deep into the hay where it was too hot. So now the ones that I replanted, I made sure that I planted more on top, but let's go and see just how hot this is down inside. Okay. What is this one? This is the one that got really, really hot. Oh, 16, 17, 8. Okay, 109, 10. Okay. Now that's, you know, that's 6 inches down inside. It's still kind of hot down there. 114, 15. Okay, so of course when they were very hot, I mean, they shot immediately up to the 185. So this is, it's still, that would still be kind of hot for the roots to be down that far. But what we're seeing is that it's cooling off, going, like if I'm just right in here, so I didn't put it down very deep, and there, you know, it doesn't even register. So anyway, these guys are all coming back. They're looking happier, and I'm glad, because they're Brandywine tomatoes, which in my mind are the very best tasting tomatoes anywhere. And then these ones down in here, these were, oh, Blossom, aren't you sweet? Thank you. Okay, but these guys were transplants here, later replantings where I pulled up some sad ones. But anyway, it's come along. So I'm just going to walk down to each bale. These are cantaloupe, and I've never successfully grown them either. Last year, I had my first good crop of tomatoes, and they were in some of my other raised beds, and I planted them really, really early. So, we got some pretty healthy looking guys. Now these guys right here, I just planted, these are seeds from the Dollar Tree store. They're a big round cherry tomato that I really like, and it's hard to find them any place in a nursery. But most of these varieties are Heritage is one that takes the heat, and I had a really good luck with that last year. I froze about 50 quarts of tomatoes last year. So, but now this is the, you know, many more tomatoes than plants than I had last year. So, okay, now this bale, you know, it lost its integrity, but these tomato plants in here look pretty happy. I didn't get it shrink wrapped with the shrink wrap quick enough. I just had the cheap plastic, so it's stepping back. Yeah, looks a little herniated there. Okay, on to the next one, corn. I've never grown corn. Now, of course, this is kind of odd having it. I mean, these guys were up the next day. It just was amazing. They've been very happy. So we'll just see how this turns out. Now over here, cucumbers. I've had cucumbers a few times, but recently I haven't had success. These guys look wonderful. Now in front, these are plants that I bought at the store. And behind them are the seeds, and the seeds are bigger than the plants now. See, so they're doing very well. And like I said, remember, this is, well, actually, this is less than 2 weeks. This is like 12 days ago when I planted. Okay, now this next bed. Now, these are pepper plants that I put in, and interesting, they initially looked the most happy of everything. But they're looking a little sad currently, and I'm not exactly sure why that is, although there's a little blossom, so yeah, there's blooms on them, so we'll see. In the middle, those are zinnia seeds, so we'll have some flowers. Okay, coming over to this one, some herb plants that I put in, they're really happy. Swiss chard, spinach didn't, this is too hot for spinach. They didn't like that very well. Now these are some herb seeds that are coming up, so we'll see what happens with them. And then across the way, zucchini. And the zucchini, I mean, I was kind of getting a little tired, so I had them spaced pretty well in the paper towel. So I just planted the whole paper towel and they came up. Just fine. Okay, so here's one variety. I don't remember what it was, but these are green beans. They look good. And then I have a few eggplant plants in this one. The eggplants, see, I planted them enough on the edge so they didn't get burned, and they were immediately happy. So they like this. Now over here, this is yellow squash, and here's another example where in the front, these were plants that I planted, and they were the crookneck yellow squash, okay, because I didn't have seeds for those, and these are the straight neck yellow squash behind them, and you can see that now they have overtaken the plants, the seeds. So, once again, very happy. And then the bale at the end here is another variety of green beans. So, now I didn't have quite as many beans come up on these as I did on the other one. Okay, so I'm going to walk around to the other side and give you a close-up of my eggplant and zucchini. Okay, and now in all the things I read, they say mushrooms are a good sign because that means that it's composting and doing what it's supposed to do. But these are the Japanese eggplant. I really like those. They're the long, skinny guys. And the I don't know if this will be the variety, but one variety I grew 1 year that actually worked. You didn't even have to peel them. The skins were really tender. Okay, zucchini. Happy zucchini. So, okay. Now, walking over here, these I'm always experimenting with different things. This is dirt bags. My husband thought I was kind of nuts, but, you know, I got my teenage son to help me fill them. So there's four rows of dirt bags. It doesn't sit up very high, but I want to have fig trees so badly. So there's some little fig trees in here and a few blackberry bushes that, oh, they're kind of coming. And then mostly, and then I did plant some of my sad tomatoes that were, yeah, they're coming back. We'll see what happens. But those are weeds. So those guys, you're going to have to die. So now, these are raised beds I built this year, and it's sort of like a lasagna garden, keyhole garden-ish. I don't have a keyhole in them, you know, but I could call them lasagna beds. The dirt bag bed and these concrete block ones, they all have logs at the bottom. In 2012, in August, we had hundreds of trees die here because of the Mexican soapberry boar beetle that could now survive further north due to our warming climate. So most of them are down now. I don't know if I can make this work, so. Okay, so way in the distance there. Yeah, I don't know if you can see those dead trees, but okay, so back to normal. Zoom here. Okay. Well, anyway, hundreds of trees. So we still do have some big old dead logs sitting around. So at the bottom, our bottom layer is cardboard, then logs, then dirt from the creek bed here, then more cardboard, and then the mulch on the top. And what I have started in here, would you see mostly are weeds, but these are artichokes. And I'm so excited I got some of those to get started. That's something that will grow here. I won't weed until I'm sure that all the artichokes have sprouted. See now, that guy, that is an artichoke. Right in the center there. Okay, so I'll see what comes up and I might move some of them around, and this will be a permanent artichoke bed. Then moving off to these last two lower raised beds, corn again. And the corn is the same height as the corn in the field, so that's a good sign in my mind. So here's another corn. So, and then the last ones I'm going to show you are my early raised beds. I first had vegetables in them, and there's a little bit of garlic coming back there, but okay, these were made from a dead swimming pool, you know, and then of course the layers, they were originally keyhole gardens with the hole in the middle to put the wet mulch, but I wasn't able to, I didn't have enough wet mulch. But just telling you, so 2 years ago, these trees in these beds, only 2 years old, and they were just sticks. They were only like probably 2-3 feet tall. But there's peach trees, and there's a persimmons tree in there. This next one has pomegranate and a couple of plum trees. And going around, this one, which I still had vegetables planted at the bottom of these last year. So like this one had tomatoes and okra. And the one at the back had the garlic and some green beans. This one had peppers, and I had a very prolific crop of peppers. I mean, my freezer is just full of peppers. They were the banana peppers and jalapenos, and they climbed all the way to the top of the trees. Okay, these are two plum trees in the back that are they're not a wild variety, but they're smaller, but still sweet. And then this is, I believe, a prune plum that I put in here. Okay, so the next garden is sad. Well, it's starting to bloom, though. It's getting a little happier. This has been my herb bed with sage and rosemary. But the rosemary, even though you see I had tried to cover it, it got you know, the cold weather got to it, so I'm going to have to cut that way back. This is my thermo fabric that protects it up to 10 degrees, but what happened, I had the whole thing covered, and pinned down, I thought, but the wind got it. So anyway, now this orange stuff, that was to protect the raised beds from free-range chickens. This year, we're just building a bigger run for our chickens, and we're not going to free-range them. It did help, though, but the chickens, of course, they'll just get in there and eat your garden. So, and then the last bed I'm going to show you is, these are onions this year. I had tomatoes in here last year, but I got these planted way back in January, so I'm hopeful. I gave them a haircut this morning. And then the last gardening thing that I have here is, I have a little greenhouse. I don't know if I'm going to take you in or not. Let's see. Okay, so the thing about a greenhouse in Texas, and these guys need some water, but, you know, it's already getting to be over 100 degrees. Now, in the wintertime, this heats pretty well by just, I have a big passive barrel. I do have a little heater, fish heater in it, but, and then I have some sun lamps. So, this is Malabar spinach, which will just, doesn't care about the heat. It's actually 2 years old. Lived through a summer of 130 degrees temperatures in here without water. So there's a couple tomato plants in the back here. And, excuse me. Okay, coming around. These guys, of course, are saying, Mommy, 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 give me water, which I will do here in a minute. So, I have some cabbage, but, you know, I think it's way too hot in here for them to make heads. But some tomatoes. There's some ripe tomatoes. And these tomato plants, I found volunteer in my little dog yard where I used to, you know, throw out scraps to free-range chickens. And so, you know, okay, so there's a little bit of switch chard and also some other, I don't even know quite what this is, but you know, they're really cold weather plants, and so they're not very happy. Now, this has been magnificent, but it's about dead now. This is a 2-year-old pepper plant, poblano peppers, and I see there's still one pepper. I just harvested and gave to a friend a week ago, about 15 peppers. But it's 2 years old. It survived 130 degrees and not being watered. But I think it's at the end. Okay. So, just one more little shot of tomatoes. Yeah. Okay. I'll be back for you. And let's go back outside. And just come around and kind of sweep it again. Potatoes to onions to all of those crops in the bales. And I'm very hopeful, although in Texas, you know, it's just, you know, harvesting. You will see people, since I moved here, you know, I would see beautiful gardens. But now I know they never really harvested anything because it can be 100 degrees the end of May. And this year, hopefully, it's not going to be worse than that. You know, I mean, some years since I've lived here, it has still been mild temperatures. We've still had, like, temperatures in the 80s in June, but I don't know if that's possible anymore. So, okay, well, signing off. Thank you.